Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's third meeting of 2021. There's been no apologies received, we're all present. And our first item is to decide whether to take item 4 in private, and that's to consider the evidence heard on the Cabinet Secretary's Session 6 priorities. Are members agreed? We are agreed. Our second item today is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Social Care on his priorities for Session 6. And all of our witnesses are appearing remotely this morning. Can I welcome Humza Yousaf, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. And he is joined by Caroline Lamb, Director General for Health and Social Care and Chief Executive for NHS Scotland. And Professor Jason Leach, the National Clinical Director. And Donna Bell, the Director for Mental Health and Social Care. Good morning to you all. So, good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move to my colleague, Paul O'Kane, who's got the first question for you today.
Thank you, Convener. And prior to starting, I would just draw members' attention to my register of interests as a councillor at East Renfrewshire Council. This morning, obviously, as we meet, we know that COVID cases have been increasing throughout the summer. And we know that there have been a number of very seriously concerning situations across our hospitals, particularly in terms of Code Black status being reached or almost being reached. So I really just want to start this morning by asking the Cabinet Secretary for his view in terms of the capacity we have to deal with current surging cases and indeed future surging cases. We know that there are concerns, for example, over staffing levels and indeed fatigue with staff. And I know we'll come on to those issues later in the agenda, but I think just a sense from the Cabinet Secretary of where we are in the pandemic now in terms of capacity and what preparedness we have for the future.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. Apologies. Thank you very much, Mr. O'Kane, and thank you, Convener, for the invitation to address committee today. I'm genuinely very sorry that I can't join you in person. I hope committee understands. Many of you will know that after a gentle game of badminton, I seem to have ruptured my Achilles. So as Dr. Gohani and Emma Harper and others with some clinical experience will tell you, I've got to keep my leg elevated for as long as possible. So I'm really sorry that I can't be in front of you in person. Can I also say, before I answer Mr. O'Kane's question in some detail, that how pleased I am to be in front of the committee and genuinely as Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, you will get from me and my team responsiveness, you'll get openness, you'll get transparency. We'll not attempt to stifle or in any way be divisive to defensive in the work we're doing, nor either will we try to be anything other than constructive to the work that committee's doing. And having been a minister for the best part of 9 years now, I've always thought that committee and government can work best when we're focused and moving in the same direction together. And so, from my perspective, I'm really looking forward to working with committee, and I'm sure that will generate more light than it will heat. In terms of the question, it's absolutely imperative. My immediate focus, as you'd imagine, from the minute that I was appointed Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, has been the pandemic and the current crisis that we're facing. And we are still in the midst of that pandemic and still, as Mr. O'Kane rightly says, facing some real significant challenge. So what our job is to do is to work with every single health board right up and down the country to maximise capacity and flex within the system. So we do have that. We have additional capacity. We base that modelling for capacity on best, medium, worst-case scenarios, and we ensure that we are able to have as much flex in the system. But I will be frank, and I intend to be frank with you, not just in this session, but in any of my appearances, that involves difficult decisions. And we are seeing that right up and down the country. Mr. O'Kane references some of those difficult decisions that are being made. And they usually involve having to take tough decisions around non-urgent elective surgery. For example, we know a number of health boards now have decided to pause that non-urgent elective surgery. It's one of the pressure valves that we have. We can't stop people from having heart attacks or having a stroke. That urgent care we have to, of course, attend to, and we will attend to, but that non-urgent care we are able to release that valve where necessary to increase the capacity within our NHS. Now, that doesn't come without consequences, of course it does, and no doubt we'll talk about backlogs, but also, of course, every paused surgery has an impact on the individual, of course, that was waiting for that elective procedure. So huge challenges. Frankly, that's why controlling transmission is our top priority, because we don't want to overwhelm an NHS that is already under extremely significant pressure.
Paul.
Thank you, Convener, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I think what he says in terms of recovery and being able to recover services. So whilst we have, for example, in a number of health board areas and a number of hospitals stopped we've made the decision around cancelling operations and surgeries. I think there is a concern about how long this will take in terms of recovering the position. So we had, for example, Professor Caroline Hiscox in NHS Grampian saying that it could take years to recover the position of being able to get people diagnosed, treated, operations that they require. And as I said in my earlier comments, we're obviously going to come on to talk about workforce pressures, but I think given what we know about workforce pressures and about the number of people who are considering, for example, leaving the medical profession, whether that be in terms of doctors or indeed the nursing profession, what is the Cabinet Secretary's view of what essentially could become a perfect storm in terms of staffing levels reducing, but also that long period required to recover the position where we're able to treat people in as normal a way as we would expect and essentially in the way that everyone would want to see in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Mr. O'Kane again for what I think is a really important question that gets to the very nub of the issue. First thing to say, of course, that NHS staffing is at record levels. We've increased NHS staffing by 5,000 whole-time equivalents over the last year. That's not to say, of course, that there aren't significant challenges. There are some areas of our NHS workforce where the vacancy rate is too high, and we're going to work to try to reduce that. But he described, he used the phrase a perfect storm. I would agree wholeheartedly with that description. The summer has seen a perfect storm, where, of course, with higher rates of transmission, because, of course, we've eased restrictions, we'd expect that to happen. We've had, of course, in the last month, schools returning as well. Understandably so, our staff are taking annual leave because they are, again, to be quite frank with you, knackered because of the last 18 months. So understandably so, are wanting to take some of that annual leave. They are undoubtedly, because community transmission is high, therefore that has an impact on those in the NHS that are having to self-isolate if they themselves test positive or become household contacts. So that is a real perfect storm as our NHS recovers. It's not like the beginning of the pandemic, where the only what we did was strip the NHS right back to urgent care, to cancer treatment, and so on. What we're doing is recovering the NHS, and therefore the headroom is a lot smaller than it was at the beginning of the pandemic. There's a lot more I could say, and the NHS recovery plan goes into a lot of detail about our plans on how we get to those ambitious targets of increasing capacity by 10% throughout the course of the plan. That involves, of course, the additional recruitment of staff, but rightly, again, as Mr. O'Kane alludes to, it will also have to require the retention of staff. And we've got a good record in that. Our pay increase for NHS staff, making them the best paid, or continuing to ensure they're the best paid in the entire UK. It's the biggest single year pay increase for the NHS, which I'm really proud of. But there's more we can do and more that we will do.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, I've got a couple of questions for you, which I guess is like looking at the issue of certification from a clinical point of view. Now, obviously, the COVID committee might want to look at it from a different point of view, but this is something that I guess that's quite topical, and we are proposing to join quite a few other European nations in having certification for vaccination. From a clinical point of view, and for, I guess, a mitigation of the impacts of COVID. Where, what's the rationale behind that? Because there's been quite a lot of, you say, you know, heat versus light. You know, there's a lot of heat around, I guess, the kind of sort of civil liberties aspect of it. But there's possibly not been enough discussion, I believe, on the kind of the rationale from a clinical point of view of why the government's doing that. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. And I'll say a little bit, and maybe the Jason Leach, our National Clinical Director, will want to come in to add more or just to correct what I'm saying. But there's two primary purposes of why we're doing what we're doing. But first and foremost, I've been very public about the fact that myself, I know the DFM, the First Minister have expressed similar, that we are taking this step, we're not taking this step lightly at all. It's really being done because of the really challenging circumstances that we're facing in terms of the case numbers. Everybody knows the case numbers yesterday were in around 7,000. So we're facing a really challenging position. And I would not have considered this if case numbers were far lower as they were previously at the beginning of the summer. But we are in a different circumstance, so therefore our thinking has to evolve. In terms of the clinical rationale, so two things to say. One, yes, this can hopefully help us to control transmission in particularly high-risk settings. Remember, the certification scheme is limited to high-risk settings. So nightclubs, and again, we can go into the reasons why we think nightclubs are high-risk settings, but they involve largely a younger age cohort, not exclusively, of course, but largely a younger age cohort. And we know that the younger age cohort has lower uptake of the vaccination. We know that some of the behaviours exhibited in a nightclub, for example, close contact behaviours, are more risky in terms of transmission of the virus as well. So in high-risk settings such as that and the other settings that we have included within any certification scheme, we hope to be able to control transmission. I think from a public perception point of view, if I was to attend the football at Parkhead, I mean, I would feel much safer knowing that everybody around me was double vaccinated too. Now, that doesn't mean that they become no-risk settings. Nobody's suggesting that. It just means that we can mitigate some of that risk. But the second point, which I think is really important, is that they will hopefully incentivise vaccination, particularly amongst that cohort where we know uptake is low. And look, it's far too early to say absolutely definitively the causation, but I was looking at the weekend figures, I was looking at Saturday and Sunday's figures of vaccination, and the first doses administered on Saturday that just passed were over 50% higher than the Saturday before. And on Sunday, the Sunday that just passed, vaccination figures for first doses was over 70% higher than the Sunday before. Now, again, too early to say absolutely definitively the causation, but if we continue to see that trend, then, of course, any rise in vaccination helps us as a society as a whole. So hopefully that helps to answer the question. I don't know, Convener, if it's appropriate to bring in the National Clinical Director, who wish to add.
Yeah, that would be really helpful. I'll bring in Professor Leach.
Hi. Morning, Convener. Morning, everybody, and thank you for having me, and welcome to your convenership. I, like Mr. Youssef, will endeavour to attend and tell the truth when you ask me to do so. It's good to be back. I look forward to when we can all be in the one room. Mr. Youssef has covered it very, very well. I would, in short, ask you to think of even that room you're in. I'm not suggesting we should create certificates for that room, but would you feel more comfortable if everybody in that room was double vaccinated or not? Vaccinated crowds are safer. There isn't any doubt about that. Now, the difference between alpha safety and delta safety is different, and there's been quite a lot of talk in the last few weeks about transmission of the delta variant only being partially reduced by the vaccine, and that is true. It's not as good at that as it was with the previous variants, but it does still reduce transmission. So I am in no doubt clinically that a vaccinated crowd is safer than an unvaccinated crowd, and then it's a matter of judgment for politicians what you do with that knowledge. That's the clinical knowledge. Then politicians have to decide if they want to do that in certain pieces of the puzzle. Crowds, nightclubs, moving back and forward to the stadia. In fact, It's not Parkhead or Ibrox we're quite so worried about, the outdoor bit. We're worried about the travel to it. We're worried about the pubs and houses around it. So getting people to be vaccinated prior to that travel, prior to all of that, is why we think it's public health sensible. The second point is about incentives, and there are lots of pieces of work all over the world about incentivisation. Some people are giving people 10 quid, some people are giving people travel vouchers, and this is a kind of behavioural science version of that, to say if you want to be able to do these, then incentives is one of the ways to do it. My third and final point is, let's not forget what this is. It's not a replacement for everything else. It's not mutually exclusive to have another list of mitigation. It's another layer. So we're not saying do this and all the other bets are off. We're saying we want to do this, but over here is still all the other things about face coverings and distancing where you can and all those things we've got used to.
Thank you. Emma Harper wanted to come in with a very brief supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. It's just a quick question. I'm not sure how many European countries or other countries have vaccine certificates or whatever we want to call them, whether they're Corona Pass or Green Pass. Are you able to help me understand how many EU countries have introduced vaccine certificates or equivalent?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't have all those countries in front of me, forgive me, but it's not uncommon. A number of European countries have those vaccination certification schemes. And actually, not to stray into the politics too much, but actually they are often countries that have governments that are centre-left or left-of-centre governments, liberal parties often in power as well, because I know there has been some worry about the encroachment into people's civil liberties, as the convener rightly mentioned, but actually a number of the countries that have brought in certification schemes, I would say their politics is more left and left of centre. So, look, there are a number of countries. What I would say is that this is not an unusual step, but I would also say to Ms Harper, what we've seen across the European continent, and we've seen it in other countries far beyond Europe as well, but in the European continent, we've seen certification schemes that have incentivised that vaccination. Certainly, I know from France, the figures, as soon as the certification scheme was announced, there was a huge spike in people looking to get vaccinated, and I'm hoping we see something similar here too.
Thank you. And now to Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd just like to go back and pick up on the topic that Mr O'Kane had started off on, and that's capacity within the NHS. We have seen alarming record low waiting times over the last 3 weeks. And just last week, the largest health board, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, which serves my constituents, warned people not to turn up to the department unless it was life-threatening. As we move into the winter period, A&E waiting times are going to be high. But what is specifically being done in this area to alleviate the problem just now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, thank Annie Wells for what I think is an excellent question. It is, again, the very heart of what we're planning for and doing at the moment. What I would say is that these are really difficult decisions, but they're not unique to Scotland, and that's not... That's no consolation for Annie Wells' constituents or my constituents that are waiting for a procedure or waiting a long time in an A&E department in the Queen Elizabeth. But it's fair to say that these are challenges that are being faced right across the entire UK, and statistics will show that Scotland's A&E, although you're absolutely right, has had extremely challenging performance, it still remains the best performing right across the UK. But again, little consolation to Annie Wells' constituents or indeed my constituents. So what's been done? Well, the immediate priority is to get through this crisis. Let's ensure that we can reduce community transmission as best we possibly can. If we do that, of course, then we alleviate the pressure of COVID patients. We have over 700 COVID patients within our hospitals at the moment. Now, that may seem like a low number, but you add that on to all the other services that the NHS is providing, then of course that all begins to add up. What else are we doing? Today, some guidance should be published by Public Health Scotland that is focused on primary care and GPs in particular. And that, I hope that guidance will allow more face-to-face consultations to take place at GP surgery at the primary. And now they're already seeing patients face-to-face, but I suspect Annie Wells, much like myself, has many constituents contacting her to say that they're finding that getting a face-to-face appointment difficult. So that can help us at the primary care end, and we'll invest more in that primary care end. We'll invest more in the ambulance service side. Again, I don't need to tell anybody around that committee table just how challenging the situation is with the ambulance service and the demand of the ambulance service. So we've just increased our investment in the ambulance service and already seeing that pay off. So we had an additional, I think it was over 60 recruits to the north and northeast of Scotland for the ambulance service last week. And then, of course, we're doing what we can in the acute side, increasing bed capacity. We've got the NHS recovery plan, and no doubt we'll come on to this, but the back end is also really important, where we've got increased levels of delayed discharge. So what we're doing is working to get kind of rapid units that can make the assessments that are necessary in order to get people back into their communities and even have bridging care plans. Even if we can't have a full care plan, can we have a bridging care plan in place that meets their needs for a period of time and allows us to work closely with the local authority or the Health and Social Care Partnership or the IGBs in order to make sure that we have that full care plan available for that individual. So I suppose what I'm getting at in short is the recovery plan backed by £1 billion investment takes a whole systems approach. There's no point us just trying to tackle A&E on its own. We're going to have to tackle the entire system if it's going to have any effect.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think you've answered all my questions in one there, but I will come back to you later on
in the
proceedings.
Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, 2 seconds. I'm concerned about recruitment and retention in the NHS recovery plan. You've said that work's underway to recruit at least 1,500 additional frontline staff required for the national treatment centres. Are you confident that you'll be able to fill these posts? There's been ongoing issues with NHS recruitment, and we've heard of pharmacists being recruited into GP surgeries, causing workforce challenges in community pharmacies. And there's a real risk that in other places that taking staff from one part of the NHS to move them to another could cause problems and won't actually solve anything in terms of recruitment. So how do you plan to avoid this and ensure that there is capacity across all services?
Cabinet Secretary.
So again, this is a really core element of our NHS recovery plan. And we've been upfront and honest. So we have increased, for example, the number of graduate places for medics year on year. We've also increased training places for certain parts of the workforce. We're doing all that to increase as best we possibly can our recruitment. But that is not going to be enough. And we've said within the plan that we will look to conduct ethical international recruitment. And I really emphasise that word ethical because, you know, what we can't do is just drain resources from parts of the world that absolutely need it. So our focus is on ethical international recruitment. And I've had a good conversation with, for example, the Scottish Academy, which is helping us and no doubt going to be a help in relation to that ethical international recruitment. But then also so is retention. Retention is a hugely important part of what we are looking to do. And in my conversations with the BMA, with the Royal College of GPs, for example, they've really stressed that retention point. Now, some of that is in our gift, and of course, we're working hard to see what we can do. And some of that isn't in our gift, and I've already had letter exchanges and conversations with the Secretary of State, Sajid Javid, who I must say I have a good relationship with, quite a frank relationship, as you'd imagine, but a good relationship with. And I've already mentioned the fact that pension changes made by the UK are having an adverse disincentive for those within the medical professions, doctors and GPs in particular. So some of that is in my gift and we'll work hard that some of that is not within our gift. So recruitment, absolutely. Retention, absolutely. Domestic recruitment, but also ethical international recruitment will be part of our plans.
Gillian?
Just to follow up on the point about GPs, some GPs have expressed concern about unhelpful messaging, particularly around GPs being closed during the pandemic. What is the government doing to try and improve communication with the public regarding the pressure GPs are under at the moment and to ensure that everybody knows they do actually have access to their GP?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, look, I will always do everything I can from a comms perspective to try to help to alleviate those pressures. Let's be absolutely clear about this. GPs are open. People can get face-to-face appointments. They can. A number of people, of course, actually prefer having the video consultation, the near-me consultation, or indeed the telephone consultation. A couple of weeks ago, phoned my own doctor. I had a bit of an eczema flare-up. It was really easy. I did it in between meetings. We had a phone call. I got the ointment that I needed, and it didn't take away from my workday. So, many people like myself may well prefer that, but there are a number of people who would prefer the face-to-face. And GPs are working extraordinarily hard. Look, everybody in the NHS is. We owe our GPs at a primary care level all the thanks in the world for the incredible work they've done. So any suggestion that they're not seeing people face-to-face because they don't want to is false. I absolutely reject it. But what I would say is that, of course, there are a number of people, members of the public, I think particularly our older elderly population that want to see a GP face-to-face, and some of the guidance published today, I think, will make that easier.
Just checking with Gillian, you had some questions around social care. Do you want to ask them now?
Yes.
Thank you.
Concerns have been raised by representatives of the social care sector that while there's an NHS recovery plan, there's not one for social care. And with legislation on a national care service coming, services still need report in the interim period between now and a national care service being established. Does the Scottish Government recognise the need for a social care recovery plan, and what plans are in place to ensure that our social care services have the appropriate support as we emerge from the pandemic and before we get national care service legislation enacted?
Cabinet Secretary.
Look, I agree wholeheartedly with what Gillian Mackay said. I suppose I would make the point, which I know Mr Mackay knows, I know it's a point that the entire committee knows, but of course the NHS and social care are so interlinked and integrated. So when there's pressure on one part of the system, there's pressure on social care also. So these are really important points to stress. And when it comes to social care, what I would say, again, to give as much assurance as I can to Ms Mackay, that we're not just waiting for a national care service to be fully operational. That will be the end of the parliamentary term to get it up and operational. We're taking action now. An example of that, of course, would be the funding, the over 60 million that we provided to ensure that our social care workers are getting at least the real living wage. And of course, we want to see how we can go even further than that in future budgets. No doubt that will be an important topic of conversation. So we're not waiting around for the national care service. We're also working really hard with the national with the social care sector when it comes to under occupancy levels. So again, you'll know the scheme that's in place for payments in around under occupancy and has been there throughout the pandemic. So we're supporting the social care sector where we possibly can. But the National Care Service is hugely important to do that. Unlike the National Health Service, of course, we can't set full terms and conditions right across, consistently across the care sector. But the National Care Service, which of course would be accountable to ministers, would be able to have that consistency of approach right across the country. And depending on what the final shape of that national care service is, that can involve a full range of care services, not just adult social care, but of course many other care services such as child services, so on and so forth, depending on the final shape of that. So again, just to summarise that, we're absolutely not waiting around for the national care service. We are working with national care providers at the moment to do what we can to help to alleviate that pressure.
Just off the back of that, before I go to my colleague Sandesh Gohani for his line of questioning, one of the, I suppose, the trickier lines that social care providers have got to balance is the protection of their residents and their clients from getting COVID and infection, versus the fact that their well-being more generally, their psychological well-being, and allowing visitors and allowing contact with loved ones and also the sort of social aspect of their work. How are we going to support social care providers to be making those judgment calls? Cabinet Secretary.
I couldn't have articulated the conundrum better myself, because that is the challenge. They are weighing up some incredibly difficult factors. And I've had meetings, my colleague Kevin Stewart has had a number of meetings with the relatives or care home relatives of those that have their family members in care homes, and you can see and get a sense from them just how difficult life has been over the last 18 months. And nobody in government, and I would absolutely confidently say nobody in the care sector, wants to keep relatives away from visiting a loved one at all. We understand the challenges of the last 18 months. So you have to balance that up with what we know is a complex residential setting involving older people, who we know are more susceptible to the most serious and severe effects of COVID. And that's why our clinical director at Public Health Scotland, our other clinicians keep really close to the social care sector to advise them on a regular basis about what can be done safely. But I'll be honest, convener, the circumstances that we find ourselves in at the moment with high levels of community transmission are having an impact on our care sector. We have, at last count I saw yesterday, over 120 care homes that have an outbreak of COVID in them. That's not an insignificant number. And therefore, difficult decisions have to be made. But I can promise you that myself, my colleague Kevin Stewart, we're looking at this on a daily basis to try to ensure that the rights of care home relatives are absolutely paramount, but while considering also the complex safety issues involved in care homes. And of course, we've made a commitment to introduce Anne's Law within the first year of this parliamentary term.
Anne's Law being the ability for a resident to have one close contact. Is that correct? Yeah.
Effectively, to have it goes even further than that. Anne's Law effectively will give rights that care home relatives can have, akin to the staff that are in care homes, for example. So really, actually expanding upon what you've just said. And of course, the final shape of what Anne's Law will look like will be up to the consideration of the committee and the Parliament as a whole, but embedding those rights so that they're in statute.
Thank you. And I'll move on to questions from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, convener. Just to draw you to attention on my register of interest, I'm a practising GP. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning. I wish you a speedy recovery. Remember, as we get older, we do need to do dynamic warming up, unfortunately. Same goes for me. So, can I just pick you up on something that you said to Gillian Mackay a bit earlier about the pension reform? Now, speaking to the BMA myself, they said there were things that the Scottish Government could do. So the Scottish Government would be able to allow consultants to come out of the pension scheme for a little period.
So I seem to have lost the connection. I got you, Dr. Gohani, when you said you spoke to the BMA.
Okay, so I spoke to the BMA, and they said there were things that the Scottish Government could do to help with the pensions issue in Scotland. So the Scottish Government were able to allow consultants to come out of the pension scheme for a period of a few months and then go back in, thus negating the problem. And that's something that has been done in other places around the UK. So would the Cabinet Secretary be able to provide me some information as to why we haven't done that yet?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to look at the issue. In my meeting with the BMA, they raised a number of issues where they thought the Scottish Government could take action. One was that issue that Dr. Gohani mentioned. Of course, all of these things undoubtedly come with a cost. There was a number of other issues that the BMA and the Royal College of GPs have raised that they think the Scottish Government could do to help with retention. And we're working closely with the BMA, with the RCGP, with the Scottish Academy and others. Where we can, we will do that. Where those powers exist elsewhere, we will, of course, work constructively with the UK Government. And I mentioned my relationship with the Secretary of State is a constructive one. He's promised to look at this issue and to come back to me and to return to me on this issue. So where we can take action, of course, we'll look to do that. If it, of course, involves an additional financial ask, then, of course, that's a decision we've got to weigh up and amongst the other recruitment and retention issues too.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, before I move on to other lines of questioning, long COVID is something that we're now having to grapple with, and many people seem to be suffering the effects of long COVID. What is the overall strategy that we have going forward to assisting people who are suffering the really complex symptoms of long COVID?
So, Convener, this answer will be slightly unhelpful given what I'm about to say, but I hope to be able to give a little bit more detail on that next week. We were due to have our debate on the NHS and social care this week, but of course, because of the need to bring forward, rightly so, a parliamentary debate on the certification scheme, we're having that debate next week, and I hope to say more about our strategy on long COVID and some of what we're considering doing in that regard to bolster the local response to long-term effects of COVID. I hope to be able to say more next week. But what we are doing currently is that we're trying to ensure that the pathways we have provide care as close to home as possible. Now, that doesn't rule out the possibility of long COVID clinics. The Health Board could do that if they wanted tomorrow. But the model of long COVID clinics doesn't necessarily work everywhere. So in NHS Highland, for example, there may be challenges in having a long COVID clinic in one part of the Highlands, and of course, considering the travel and the distances required, could cause some issues and some problems for people suffering the long-term effects of COVID in other parts of the Highlands. So that one model doesn't always fit. Doesn't mean it doesn't have merit. And again, I would just reiterate that if a health board wanted to create a specialist clinic, they can do. So the point is that when it comes to current referral, there is a current referral pathway. There is an implementation note there with GPs around the long-term effects of COVID. But essentially, using existing services, we're trying to get people the treatment, the best treatment they can get in the long term, closer to their home as possible. But also what we're trying to do is understand more about long COVID. So that's why we're investing in research to understand more, because our understanding of long COVID and the long-term effects of COVID is evolving day by day.
Thank you. I'm going to go back to Sandesh Gohani, who has some questions around staffing.
Thank you, Convener. So I'd like to ask Cabinet Secretary about the 10% increase in key services that is part of the plan here. What's the timescale for delivery of this?
Cabinet Secretary.
So it's all in our NHS recovery plan. It should be said that when it comes to that 10%, that's largely in relation to that 10% increase for outpatient activity we'll meet by the end of the parliamentary term. But actually, by the end of the parliamentary term, inpatient and day case activity should increase by closer to 20%. You'll find that on page 5 of the recovery plan. But also, we go into detail about how year on year we'll increase inpatient activity, outpatient activity, diagnostic activity as well. I note, and I'm still waiting for the detail, but I note that the UK government are due to make an announcement today around their own plans. And my understanding from what we're hearing so far and what has been communicated in the media is that they will also look to increase capacity by 10%. So I'm pleased that they've no doubt had a look at our recovery plan and seen that ambition and are going to themselves try to match it. But we'll, of course, wait for the detail in that regard. But I think what I would say is what I said to Mr. O'Kane earlier on. We will be realistic, ambitious, of course, but realistic in terms of the timescales that it will take to clear these backlogs and get our NHS returned back to complete normality.
Thank you. So from your answer, we're looking at 5 years to get to the 10%. My worry is we continue to fall back as we're trying to achieve this. And one of the aims that I saw was about, one of the key aspects was the redesign of the care pathways. So could you tell me a little bit more about how you plan to redesign the care pathways to achieve the target?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so what I would say is when it comes to outpatient activity, you'd be right, and that's the parliamentary term, we think at the moment, to reach that 10%. But what I would say is when it came to additional inpatient and day case activity, we'd hope to get there by 20, 22-23, so hopefully we'll get to that 10% a little bit earlier. And the significant increases in diagnostics, I think, are really important. So what we're doing is, when it comes to pathways, I missed part of your question, but was it on particular pathways, or was it referral pathways that you referenced? And forgive me, my connection seems to be timing out a little bit.
So it was about the redesign of care pathways. The paper says that one of the key aspects would be the redesign of care pathways. So just asking for more details about that.
So yeah, I mean, for example, when it comes to our cancer pathways, we're already trying our best to try to get early diagnostics. That is a key part of trying to help alleviate the pressures on the system. We know that if we can get people that care earlier, particularly when it comes to cancer treatment, they've got a better chance of recovery. That means, of course, that they're less likely to end up in our hospitals for longer, for example. And our early cancer diagnostic centres are clearly a part of that. So, you know, the earlier we can get people referred into the system, such as, for example, early cancer diagnostic centres, the better chance we have of alleviating that pressure, the better chance we have of seeing more people through the system. And obviously, we already have some of those early cancer diagnostic centres already up and running.
And can I also ask about workforce planning? So speaking to the Association of Anaesthetists, they think there are 2,000 shortages across the country, when only 1,000 are currently being said. And speaking to the Royal College of Nursing, they say there are 3,000 nursing vacancies. So even with the significant increases that are in the paper that we're going to be seeing, we're still barely going to be achieving parity, let alone looking at increasing the workforce. If we look at the people who are leaving because of COVID, they stayed a bit longer than they're leaving, and the natural turnaround. So how could we address this?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think the question is a really good one. I think I perhaps touched upon it when I was giving my answer to Ms. Mackay. I'm not going to pretend to you, I've been insulting your intelligence and the public's intelligence if I suggested that we're able to meet these ambitious recruitment targets simply by domestic recruitment. We will do that. We'll also try to recruit from other parts of the common travel area, but clearly ethical international recruitment will be part of what we're doing. Training as well. Are we getting the absolute most out of the current staffing cohort that we have? Can we train them to an even higher level, and can we incentivise them to stay for longer? Again, a number of the organisations and stakeholder and member organisations that I suspect Dr. Gohani has met and that committee members have met tell me that retention is a key issue here. So we're working hard to see how we can retain, and where those powers are in our gift, and of course we have to use them, where they're in the gift of other governments, we'll work constructively with them. Because these are common challenges. The challenges faced by GPs and consultants, for example, in Scotland will be probably very similar to the issues faced in other parts of the UK. So essentially, yes, invest in the pipeline, make sure there's an increase in training places, graduate places, increase when it comes to recruitment domestically, but also retention and ethical international recruitment all are part of the mix.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, Convener. I think we're having a discussion at the moment in terms of our long-term future planning, and indeed I think a lot of our work across these next many years will be dominated by workforce planning issues and ensuring that we get that recovery right. But I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would say something about the particular imminent challenges we have in terms of winter, because I think we're about to embark upon a very difficult winter period in the NHS. I note that the National Workforce Strategy is going to be published in December, but obviously, you know, by then we're into those winter pressures, and I think indeed a lot of those recommendations will take time to flow through. So I think just in terms of those pressures on staffing for the winter period, and it goes back to not just NHS, but I think also social care in terms of being able to discharge people from hospital more quickly and having care packages in place. Just keen to understand the Cabinet Secretary thinking on that.
Cabinet Secretary.
So again, forgive me, it timed out slightly, but I got the gist, I think. But forgive me if I don't answer anything, please, I'm happy to go back to Mr. O'Kane. He's absolutely right. Nobody is waiting for a workforce plan at the end of the year to take imminent and immediate action. That's why our staffing levels are the highest they've ever been. We've got a record number of people working in NHS in terms of whole-term equivalents. We have 5,000 additional staff, again, WTE, whole-term equivalents, working in NHS this year, compared to last year. So we're investing in staffing right here and right now. Important to make that point. But what we're also doing, and we have had ambitious plans right across the NHS. So we're increasing, as you know, we have targets to increase the number of GPs, the number of paramedics, the number of mental health workers, the number of community links workers, and that investment is happening now. And we are increasing, and of course, paramedics, if I didn't mention them, in terms of an ambulance service, we're investing right here and right now. We're also undertaking a campaign. This is where I slightly lost your connection, but I think it was around social care. What we're doing at the moment is working really hard with the sector to see what we can do to retain the current staff, but also do a bit of marketing, a bit of communication to try to incentivise people into social care, but also those graduates that are studying social care to make sure that they then go on to work in social care, not go off to another profession. So working with them while they're still in their university courses, while they're still doing their courses in college, to try to attract them to stay within social care. But I will be very frank and very honest with you, that side of things in terms of recruitment into social care is probably one of the elements that gives me the most significant concern, because we don't have the same levers we would have in the NHS over social care.
Okay, I'm going to go to Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. It's just to pick up on what you're saying, Cabinet Secretary, about cancer pathways and I suppose looking at modernising patient pathways approach. We've got the diagnostic centre in Dumfries and Galloway. That's one of the first ones that started, and I believe that they're doing really, really well as far as fast-tracking people that don't have concrete symptoms of cancer. So that's something that has been introduced that's working quite well initially, I understand. I'm also interested in whether the Modernising Patient Pathways programme is looking at cancer pathways in general, like, for instance, people in Stranraer and Wigtonshire go to Edinburgh for their radiotherapy, which is a longer journey time and travel time when they basically drive past the Beetson, for instance. Is that something that is part of the Modernising Patient Pathways programme, looking at shorter travel time, shorter journey time, maybe having a different overall approach to the whole cancer pathway programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
In short, yes. And the refreshed cancer framework, the framework for effective cancer management, forgive me, I'll double check when we're hoping to publish that, but it hopefully will be in a matter of weeks. That will go into the detail of exactly what Ms. Harper is saying, making sure that we have the right treatment at the right time and in the right place for people. And we recognise there's challenges with that. Even pre-pandemic, there was challenges, let's be honest, about some of the challenges in rural areas in terms of cancer referral and pathways. So the refreshed framework in terms of cancer management, the effective cancer management framework, will help to address some of those issues.
Okay. Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. Very briefly, Cabinet Secretary, other than the measures you've already laid out about GP recruitment, I wanted to ask specifically about out-of-hours services. The pressure on those who do out-of-hours GP work is particularly acute at the moment, given the pressures elsewhere in the NHS, and they are a particularly dedicated workforce. What else can we do to ensure that GPs' well-being and the want to continue to contribute towards the out-of-hours services can be prioritised while we recover from COVID, given the pressures in other places that undoubtedly mean that more people are accessing out of hours than potentially previously were?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, again, these are all really important questions. Two things. One is we are looking proactively at the moment on how we incentivise the out of hours working, because we know how challenging that is, but we also know how important it is in terms of our recovery. So we're looking at what can we do to further incentivise out of hours working, but we'd have to do that, as Ms McKay I know would understand and appreciate, working with the trade unions, working with the staff side representatives, in order to ensure that they are comfortable with what's being proposed. So we're still looking to finalise a lot of the detail on that. And then the important part, which I think Ms McKay touches upon, and which I'm happy to see more if we get into this in more detail, is wellbeing. That's important for out of hours, but it's important for everybody. I, on my very first visit as Health Secretary, in Lanarkshire, and I was blown away by the testimony I was hearing from healthcare workers and NHS staff more generally. I spoke to, as you'd imagine, I spoke to the porter, I spoke to the cleaning staff, I spoke to the doctors, the nurses, and everybody in between, and they were all telling me the same thing. It doesn't matter what the job was, they were knackered. They were really, really tired because of the last 18 months. And that's why we're investing £8 million in their wellbeing. Some of those are very specialist services, but they provide a whole range of services. I won't go into the detail of it right now, just for brevity, but there's a whole range of services that are available. And I think this is crucial. If we're going to ask our NHS to help us with recovery, which is vital, then we're going to have to make sure their wellbeing is absolutely paramount.
And Stephanie? You don't have to press your microphone, Stephanie. It's done for you.
Thank you. Thanks. Cabinet Secretary, we were speaking earlier, just a short while ago, Emma was mentioning cancer. And I'm wondering, has there been any kind of exploration of the idea of lung cancer screening? Clearly, it's, the most common cancer. And also, as far as deprivation goes, it's 3 times more likely for people to suffer from it. So I'm just wondering if there's been work done around that, or if there's any intention to carry out any work around that. Thanks.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, I'll, if it's okay, Convener, I'll probably pass over to the National Clinical Director. But, of course, Ms Callaghan is absolutely right. When it comes to our more challenging pathways, when it comes to cancer, we look at the most common cancers. We know, of course, the largest preventable illness and cause of preventable death is around smoking, and in around cancers associated with smoking, of course, of which lung cancer is one. But I'm happy, if it's okay with your indulgence, convener, to pass over to the National Clinical Director, who may be able to say a little bit more about lung cancer specifically.
Thank you. Professor Leach.
Hi. Yes, we have a process by which we decide what to screen for, and that is a screening committee. So we have a group who look at the most recent global data, what is the risk benefit of screening and what form of screening it should take. So is it blood test, is it an x-ray, is it a mammogram, what is the mechanism by which you would find the cancers? And presently that data suggests no, you shouldn't do routine population level lung cancer screening for any particular age group. But if that changes, or that committee sees something, or the world sees something that would change that, then of course they would do it. Now, there are other places where that screening might happen after a GP makes a specific choice based on symptoms, based on previous employment, based on age, all of those things are available. But population level screening is quite a rare thing, and we only do it for a small number of cancers at any specific time, because the risk has to outweigh the benefit of doing that at a broad population level. So to my knowledge, we're not looking at it in any further depth, but CabSec and I will ask that committee just to make sure I haven't missed anything and we'll write to you.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Paul Kane, who also has a cancer-related question while we're on this topic.
Thank you, Convener. I think just keen to hear something more in terms of the early centres that we've heard alluded to already. In terms, we know the delays that were there in terms of setting those up. I'm keen to understand, because I think there is a real sense that they add so much value in terms of earlier diagnosis, in terms of opening up new pathways for people who perhaps don't have as clear cut symptoms. There's a sense, I think, that we could really utilise them in every health board area. So I would be keen to understand from the Cabinet Secretary what the plans are to roll out further and indeed timescales.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so I can give obviously in writing if it's helpful, but our early cancer diagnostic centres, of course, the first of those are already open, but it's so important that when it comes to initiatives like the early cancer diagnostic centres, that we do a proper evaluation of those before we decide to roll them out even further. And so we have actually procured an external evaluation with an academic institution, and they will then provide that important monitoring and hopefully positive evaluation. I have to say I've been to the Early Cancer Diagnostic Centre in Fife in the Victoria Hospital, and I was really impressed. It was only open for a few weeks, but they'd already detected a number of early cancers and a number of patients already. And although it was only a few weeks and those were small in number, no doubt the impact, not just in the NHS, but in those individuals and their families would be absolutely great. So the first day centres need to bed in. We need to get the data, we need to analyse what's happening with them. But what I would say, that evaluation will then inform on an ongoing basis the delivery and rollout of further centres. But what I would say also to Mr O'Kane is that the early cancer diagnostic centres are one too. I was also at the Centre for Sustainable Delivery based at the Golden Jubilee, and I should say if committee would like to visit the CFSD, they would be more than happy, I'm sure, to host you. I would really highly recommend it. But they are looking at, for example, a variety of innovative technologies, like a colon capsule, for example, that will help with not just detection of cancer, but also the speed and the comfort of the patient by which that can be done. So the ECDCs, the Early Cancer Diagnostic Centres, are important, but they are one tool and amongst a range of tools that we're hoping to deploy to in order to help us, particularly in that diagnostic part of the cancer journey, because we know when we look at the 62-day target that it is the diagnostic side which is letting us down in terms of not meeting that target.
Thank you. We're going to move on to questions from colleagues on mental health and open up with Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. And for the record, I am also a councillor at Stirling Council. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. My questions are around the CAM service. I have had a lot of anxious constituents in touch, and I know generally I am the Stirling constituency, but I know generally there's a problem across Scotland. Can you give us a flavour of how the recovery plan is going to address this issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
And I thank Ms Tweed for what's a really important question. I suspect she's not the only MSP. I suspect every single one of us receives really difficult cases into our inbox and our advice surgeries from desperate family members when it comes to the criticality of their children's mental health. What I would say is there's a number of things that I'll try to say on this, but I'll try to keep them brief, but I can go into more detail if Ms Tweed or other members want. First and foremost, we're investing in services that I would say are pre-CAMS. So before people get to that crisis intervention point, we're investing in a number of interventions that we hope can help at much earlier stage so that CAMS crisis intervention isn't needed. And that programme of local interventions is again designed to be suitable for whatever that local need is. So it may be different in Stirling than it would be in Selkirk, and it would be in other parts of the country. So really, really important that we invest in that. And some of that will include, for example, making sure we have the appropriate services in place in schools. And again, I won't go into the detail in this question, but I'm happy to expand upon what we've done to ensure that we are getting more and more resource into schools. As Ms Tweed probably will know, that we have we had a CAMHS task force. They gave us evaluation of the service, recommendations within the service, and she knows that we're investing quite significantly within the CAMHS service. In fact, we have some of that detail within the NHS recovery plan. One of those will be staff recruitment. We intend to provide funding to increase recruitment to CAMHS by 320 additional mental health workers. So that increase in the staff cohort undoubtedly will work. I'll be honest, the wait for treatment in CAMHS for me is unacceptable. We are not meeting, as we know, that 90% standard. We weren't, I'm afraid, meeting it pre-pandemic either, and therefore we've invested additional funding specifically to target CAMHS waiting lists. So 29.2 million to NHS boards to improve CAMHS, and 4.25 million of that focused directly on those who are currently on the CAMHS waiting list at the moment. Look, there is a lot more that I could say, but for the sake of brevity, I'll hand back to Ms Tweed, who may well, I'm sure, will have some follow-up questions.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary, for that. I also note that nearly a quarter of CAMHS referrals are rejected. Can you tell us what happens to the children and young people whose referrals are rejected?
So, no, this has been a long-standing issue that has been raised by a number of people, and also certainly in the last parliamentary session too. And it's why we brought forward a group, independent group, to look in detail around the rejected referrals. So, an audit was done of rejected referrals, and a number of recommendations were made. We accepted, this was in 2018, we accepted all of the recommendations of that group. We've implemented the CAMHS service specification. So that sets out the standards of service that children and young people should expect, and families, of course, can expect when it comes to CAMHS, and we've funded boards to implement that specification. But what I would also say is that within that specification, it's very, very clear and black and white that there's a very clear expectation that services should be appropriately re-engaged where necessary. As I mentioned already, we provide additional funding, about £15 million of funding to local authorities to deliver locally based mental health interventions and wellbeing support for 5 to 24-year-olds in their communities. And these services are linked very closely to CAMHS, so they can ensure signposting. So if an individual is rejected and the referral is rejected by CAMHS, then they're not just left to their own devices, but signposted to one of those local interventions. I suppose, ultimately, of course, these are not decisions for ministers to make in terms of referrals or whether they're accepted or not. These are important clinical decisions, but I hope that no young person would be left without any support whatsoever, given the mental health challenges they may be facing.
Okay. And questions from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Jen. Cabinet Secretary, I should probably have said earlier on that I am a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council. I'm also a parent to an autistic child as well. And I was wondering specifically, just as a follow-on from Evelyn's question there, about parents with children in the autism spectrum disorder. I know that certainly looking at the number of kids that have been turned down, if you like, from CAMHS, you've got parents that wait a really long time for that referral to come through, and there's a lot of hope behind that as well. And it can be quite devastating for them when their children are then refused CAMHS support. And it's just to ensure, I know that you've spoken about the audit and lots of things been implemented there, but I'm still hearing the same story from parents. So I'm wondering what assurances you can give the children with autistic spectrum disorders and other additional support needs, that we will find suitable pathways to support those children. Thanks.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I thank Ms Callaghan for not just the question, but for disclosing how it's affecting and how it may have affected her personally, but also people that she may well, other families that she may well know that have a child that has autism. Can I take that one away, if you don't mind? And because I would be deeply worried if I was to look into the data in detail, if that the amount of referrals that were being rejected was disproportionately affecting children that had autism. And if that is happening, that gives me a real level of concern. I'd have to look at why that's happening. So if you don't mind, I will take that one away. Oh, what I will do before I pass back to Ms. Callaghan or the convener, I don't know if there's anything further that Donna Bell, the Director for Mental Health, Mental Wellbeing, wishes to add to that.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. So I don't have the data in front of me that sets out the split between neurodevelopmental referrals and other referrals, so we can certainly seek that out. We do have a similar service spec for neurodevelopmental conditions that sets out the same expectations that are in place for broader CAMHS referrals, so certainly happy to share that with the committee in due course.
Thank you, that would be very helpful. We're now going to move on to questions around health inequalities, and Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, convener. I think undoubtedly the pandemic has exacerbated health inequalities, and I think we've all seen both quantitative and qualitative data that shows that. I also think public health has never been perhaps so in focus for people in Scotland and so sharply understood and perhaps in our homes on a daily basis. So I think as we look further ahead and taking the learning from COVID, I suppose I'm keen to understand from the Cabinet Secretary what are the key interventions he sees, you know, as we move beyond COVID into recovery, and would he support, for example, the paper that was released yesterday by British Heart Foundation and 9 other charities looking at non-communicable diseases and suggesting that there must be very quick interventions around things like advertising on e-cigarettes, on how we monitor you know, sugar content in foods, and also how we essentially plan better for smoking cessation and obesity services. So I think just to get the Cabinet Secretary's thoughts on those.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. Again, I'll try to give a flavour, and then if Mr. O'Kane wishes to follow up in more detail on a specific point, I'm more than happy to do that. So first and foremost, we know, of course, that so many of the health inequalities that our constituents up and down the country face is linked to poverty. And that's why the role that the Deputy First Minister has in relation to COVID recovery is so, so important. He is convening weekly meetings between portfolios, across portfolios, where cabinet secretaries and ministers are working closely together, and we always have, but in a way that I've with extra energy, additional focus on ensuring that we're working cross-portfolio. We're not compartmentalising, we're not working in silos, because ultimately what affects my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Education, has an impact in my portfolio, which could end up having an impact in the justice portfolio, for example. So we all know the interlinkages that exist. So from a government perspective, if I can give any assurance to Mr. O'Kane, it's that we're working on these issues on health inequalities cross-government in a way that has a real determined focus, and that's helped by the role that the DFM plays. We also know that the pandemic hasn't been felt equally. It would be wrong to say, you know, quote unquote, we're all in it together, though that has some truth to it. There's some people that undoubtedly have been hit harder, far harder by the pandemic, as opposed to somebody like me, who, thank goodness, is in a comfortable position in terms of his health, notwithstanding challenges at the moment, but with his health and indeed and comfortable in terms of my own financial circumstances too. So we are absolutely focused that when it comes to recovery, we have to ensure that some of those systemic inequalities that existed in the system are weeded out. How will we do that? Well, the Women's Health Plan is one example of how we're looking to do that. 66 actions that are looking to address women's health. And we know that women's health in some aspects women face greater inequalities when it comes to their health. We're also, for example, looking to publish very shortly our immediate priorities, a priority plan for race equality. That will go into a level of detail about how we intend to work through the inequalities that exist in amongst our minority communities. We know that BAME communities are often hit harder when it comes to health inequalities, and particular health inequalities, than their white Scottish counterparts. And so there's a range of actions that we're taking. He also mentions rightly some of the important public health interventions, from smoking cessation to obesity plan, particularly in amongst children. And again, I won't go into the detail of it right now, but if Mr. O'Kane wishes me to go into detail, I can do. But safe to say, my concern has been that throughout the pandemic, some of the work that the good progress we've made in around smoking cessation, alcohol and the consumption of alcohol, and tackling obesity, some of that, I'm afraid, we haven't been able to make progress during the pandemic because of the immediacy of dealing with COVID. But I'm very, very keen, not just keen, actually, we're working hard now to make sure that we're getting refocused back on some of those important public health interventions.
Okay. I'm going to bring in Carol Mockin, who has some questions on this theme.
Thanks to the Cabinet Secretary. I was heartened to hear the response around dealing with the root causes, very important in this section. I wanted to ask specifically, following Paul's question, just about childhood obesity and approaches particularly to young people. Would he agree that it is important that we get those things right early on, so that we can look at people having long, healthy lives, and that we do make sure we target this areas of deprivation to ensure that at least we start off with a fair start in life across all the communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
But again, Ms. Mockin gets to the very heart of the issue. I'm not surprised, given her experience before she was an MSP and the issues that she's raised in the chamber, that her understanding of this issue she clearly has a great understanding of this very issue. I'm extremely focused on ensuring that we weed out some of those inequalities that have existed in the system before. This may sound quite a challenging thing to say in the middle of a global pandemic, but actually the pandemic, and because we have to remobilise and rebuild, presents an opportunity to do that in a way perhaps we may not have had before. In terms of childhood obesity, we of course have a very ambitious target, but one that I think is achievable, to have childhood obesity by 2030. We've got to do that through a range of actions. We've got to make healthy food easier to access for people that are in areas of highest deprivation. I remember very clearly when I was on the Public Audit Committee before I was a minister 10 years ago, going into the heart of Drumchapel and having a session at the health centre there. And one of the users of the health centre said to me, look, don't you politicians come and lecture me about healthy eating when, you know, I've got, you know, 2-3 takeaways right beside me. They cost half what it would cost me to go to the supermarket to get a healthy meal. And she was right to put that challenge to us. Now, in 10 years, we've managed to make some progress, and we've seen some of the effects of that progress. But what I'm looking to do is, we've commissioned research to understand in a lot more detail how health systems can support pregnant women, because we want to do this as early as we possibly can, you know, pre-birth, and to focus on children in the early years. How can we put more interventions in place so that they eat well? We've made £650,000 available to NHS boards and community projects to work with families to prevent childhood obesity. We'll invest £3 million this financial year to improve young people's weight management services. But also, as I mentioned before, we'll work constructively with the UK government where we can. So they have the responsibility for, as you know, TV advertising. And I welcome very much their commitment to ban junk food advertisements on TV before the 9 p.m. watershed. I want them to go even further. I want to look at online advertising of less healthy food and drink, and how do we restrict that as well. And in fairness to the UK government, they are keen to work with devolved administrations on these shared issues and agendas.
Ms. Mockin, are you content with that? Would you like to follow up?
No follow-up questions on this one, thank you.
Okay. Stephanie, you had some questions on health inequalities.
Yeah, thank you very much. I wanted to ask about, I mean, pre-pandemic, childhood ACEs were probably possibly the biggest public health issue that was faced in Scotland, and poverty is a strong reinforcing factor around those ACEs. So the evidence tells us that toxic stress results in health problems that go right into adulthood, so heart attacks, strokes, addiction, even increased cancer rates there as well. Now, clearly, the impact in the NHS of growing ACEs could be absolutely huge going forward. And I'm wondering how you're looking at actually having health and social care partnerships, local authorities, public health, all of those people knitting together to actually bring forward policies that really support and prevent a lot of this, and therefore down the line as well are saving people going to the NHS as well with those issues. Thanks.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to Ms Callaghan, you know, the work that has been done on adverse childhood experiences on ACEs is something that we pore over as government ministers, not just as Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, but I know my ministerial colleagues and cabinet colleagues that we pore over on a regular basis, but also informs a lot of the interventions and initiatives that we look to bring forward. Because it doesn't just have a health impact. I know we're focusing, obviously, understandably, on health. But when I was Justice Secretary and I looked at those people that were in my prisons and looked at those people who were in our care in Pullman, it was hardly a surprise, deeply disturbing and, of course, regrettable that those within our prison system, the number of ACEs that they had far outweighed the average number of ACEs that may be suffered by the average person out with a prison setting in the population. So adverse childhood experiences have massive health impacts, but also impacts, negative impacts, adverse impacts right across the entire, society, let alone other government priorities too. So if I can give an assurance to Ms Callaghan is that we place a lot of considerable weight on the research and evidence. And I know some of that can be, some of the evidence can be quite controversial. Some people have critiqued the adverse childhood experiences model, but from a government perspective, we believe in the general principle that if you could intervene as early as you possibly can, pre-birth, hence why some of the initiatives I've already mentioned, of course, the baby box, giving every child a best start in life. But you know, if we can intervene as early as possible, then we know that there's a better chance of weeding out some of those inequalities that then undoubtedly go on to have the health impacts and other societal impacts that Ms Callaghan rightly mentioned.
Okay. Would you like to come back in, Stephanie?
Yes, please. That's great. That's really, really good to hear. I suppose one of the things that's really worrying me the most is the fact that, you know, sometimes it's like a big jigsaw that doesn't quite fit together properly and you're kind of trying to hammer pieces into place. And it's really about, you know, actually getting those different organisations to really work together as far as developing policies concerned as well, so that it can work as effectively as possible. So that would really be where the focus of my question is.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, and if it gives any comfort to Ms Callaghan, know that we have extremely regular contact with those that are on the ground, because we know we can set all the national policy in the world, but we know that local delivery partners are key to what we're trying to do. Hence why our investment is usually focused to local delivery partners, whether that's the NHS board level, whether it's IGBs, whether it's health and social care partnerships, whether it's community-based and third sector organisations, which are already doing such good work pre-pandemic, let alone the good work they've done during the pandemic. So if there's any comfort to Ms Callaghan, give an absolute assurance that every single Cabinet Secretary and Minister works closely, and the Deputy First Minister coordinates a lot of this work with our local delivery partners.
Thank you. And now questions from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Just to pick up on what Paul Kane said earlier about the report that came out yesterday about non-communicable disease prevention priorities from the charities and British Heart Foundation, prevention of ill health is obviously something that we can be focusing on. We took evidence in the last session about £90 million being spent on complications of type 2 diabetes. And so if we can prevent those complications in the first place through social prescribing, perhaps, that's a way to help keep people out of hospital, as well as looking at pulmonary rehabilitation. So I'm wondering, Cabinet Secretary, are you going to continue to support wider implementation of pulmonary rehab, and also what work will be done looking at social prescribing as a way to help reduce ill health in the first place?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. Yes, I should apologise. I didn't answer that part of Mr O'Kane's question. It was not done in any way to try to be evasive. So I have seen the report by British Heart Foundation released yesterday, and by a number of other charities on non-communicable diseases. Of course, we'll take time to look at the recommendations, but anything that comes from the British Heart Foundation and many of the charities that were involved in that report will get, will be given considerable weight and attention for me. In terms of the broader issues that Emma Harper mentioned, she has a track record of speaking about issues in relation to diabetes and recognising her own personal journey in that regard. So I think there's probably little for me to say other than I agree with her on that. In terms of broader issues around social prescribing, there was a recommendation, a committee report on this in the last session, I think. In terms of the 2020 programme for government, we included a commitment at that time to establish a short life working group to examine the provision, of social prescribing of physical activity and sport. The group's remit will be to identify and communicate social prescribing examples of best practice, and then they'll also co-produce resources for practitioners as well. The establishment of that group was delayed because of the pandemic, and I hope that's understandable. However, my officials, they're currently looking, as we speak, at the best way of taking forward that short life working group, which will also look at the previous committee's report and recommendations into social prescribing.
We will be moving on to technology questions from David Torrance, but I just want to check with Emma. You want to come back in with a supplementary?
Just that I forgot to say, everybody's registering that they have an interest. I am still a registered nurse. I better make sure that that is on the record as well.
Thank you for that. And then we move on to questions around the technology being used during the pandemic and the future for that with David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In Session 5 of the Health and Sport Committee, reported on the creation of a national digital platform and the problems around data sharing. With a huge increase in the use of technology, which is around, before the pandemic, was about 1,200 a week consultations, and is now sitting at 12,000 a week consultations. What progress has been made on the use of a single digital platform and on the problems around data sharing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank David Torrance for his question. So first and foremost, we have seen the effective deployment of technological solutions throughout the pandemic. We talked a lot, I'm sure we continue to talk a lot about the near me video technology that existed and the number of consultations now taking place using that digital technological platform is a positive. It shows that people have confidence in it. To practitioners as well as the patients too. My observations from being Health Secretary, I don't know if I can still say I'm new to post, but relatively new to the post, is that we've still got a fair way to go when it comes to the interoperability of our digital systems. At the moment, and he's right to reference the National Digital Service that was established in 2018, and that's going to deliver, as he rightly says, the National Digital Platform. We've always been up front. That is going to take some time. That was obviously established pre-pandemic. The pandemic has undoubtedly delayed some of that work. But effectively, the aim remains the same. The key aim is interoperability. using different information systems, devices, applications to access information to make sure we can integrate it in a way that is coordinated, and it has to work right across organisations. It has to work across regions, across NHS boards, and across national boundaries to seamlessly transfer that information and to then optimise the interventions for individuals as best we possibly can. So a range of actions have taken place and are taking place. I can go into detail on that if Mr. Torrance wishes me to do so. I can obviously write to committee. It's quite lengthy in terms of what we're doing across the various different systems that exist, but we're making progress, but clearly some of that progress has been affected by the pandemic.
David.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you answered my colleague Julian Mackay earlier about face-to-face consultations with GPs. Is that guarantee there for any individual who wants a face-to-face consultation with any part of the NHS sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
So ultimately, that's the position we want to get to, but we have to, of course, still remind ourselves that we are in the midst of a global pandemic, and there are important infection prevention control measures still in place. And so GPs are seeing patients face-to-face, and we want them to increase the number that they're seeing face-to-face, and that should be, of course, those that are at the most need. But of course, ultimately, the short answer to Mr. Torrance's question is yes, we want to get to that position. But also we know that from surveys that have been conducted, in some surveys, over 80% prefer the digital or telephone appointments with the doctors for lots of different reasons. It doesn't maybe interfere with their day as much. But for those that prefer face-to-face consultation, then of course we want to get to a position where they have that opportunity to do so. But we just have to be mindful that we're still in the midst of a global pandemic. We still have a very highly transmissible virus that we're still contending with.
David, are you happy with that? Would you like to ask
a final question, Convener? With the use of new technologies and platforms, Cabinet Secretary, what safeguards are put in place to protect patient data?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we know how important an issue this is, understandably so, for customers, patients, you know, everybody in society. Whether you're whether you have an app on your phone that gets your Uber Eats, or whether it's an app that's linked to a public service such as health, the storage and ethical storage of that data and security of that data is hugely, hugely important. One of the first meetings I had as Cabinet Secretary for Health was with our cybersecurity team, who had an external consultant who was helping us to work through the issues of security within our NHS systems, and they're doing a detailed amount of work. We have a refreshed digital health and care strategy. We're going to publish a refreshed digital health and care strategy, but that will commit to the development of our first ever dedicated data strategy for health and social care that will include detailed consideration of how to increase our citizens' trust and transparency in data sharing. How do we unlock the value of health and care data, but doing that in a way that, of course, data can be safeguarded and there's full transparency over how that data will be used. So security is also very, very important, and cyber security testing has already been carried out for all of our major systems, including Near Me. But also we know, of course, when it comes to our COVID certification, and particularly because this is a very topical issue, we will ensure that we have up-to-date security provision in place, particularly when, of course, the app is ready to go live at the end of this month.
And we have a very short supplementary question from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. Just on the point of data, especially going forwards with everything that you have set out, who is responsible? Who's the Caldecott Guardian for this data, and how are we ensuring that if it is doctors and GPs, that there are security for that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so it depends again what system we are talking about, but obviously we comply with all the regulations and statute, and of course ultimately we will be accountable to the Information Commissioner as office in relation to how we use that data, and that's exceptionally important. So depending on the system, will depend on who the data controller is. If it gives Dr. Gohani any comfort, there's already regular engagement with the Information Commissioner's office when it comes to the development and introduction of any new system. But what I would say is that we're already working, our centre, our cyber centre of excellence is already working hand in glove with practitioners on the ground to when it comes to the development of current system, new systems, but also the current systems that we have. So I'm sure, I don't need to tell Dr. Gohani, of course, you'll be well aware in the other role that he has in primary care, that our practitioners on the ground are usually well aware of their responsibilities in relation to the handling of data. But if there's anything more we need to do in that respect, particularly with the development of new systems, then of course I'm more than happy to take any suggestions.
Thank you. We were scheduled to finish around about now, but with everyone's approval, we've still got women's health to cover, and it's a very important topic. And we should be finished in about 15 minutes, but I really do want to give this an airing, not least declare that I was on the CPG for Women's Health, which called for a Women's Health Plan, so very pleased that that's now in the programme for, well, being hopefully been in the programme for government. I've got a number of people wanting to ask questions on the Women's Health Plan, and I'll go first of all to Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. I was just looking to find out when we will see an implementation plan for the Women's Health Plan, and will it include sort of specific timescales for things coming forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Convener, if it helps you at all, and obviously I'm entirely at your behest, but I can stay on an extra half hour till 11:30, but I know you've got other committee business that you need to get on with. So my time is not constrained. I'm happy to stay in front of committee for as long as is necessary. In terms of the Women's Health Plan, sorry, apologies, my daughter's managed to drop my crutches. But in terms of the Women's Health Plan, we have within the health plan implementation goals, both in terms of the short, the medium and the long term. So the 66 actions set out there. Delivery within the short term means within 1 year. Medium term, we look at about 1 to 3 year timescale, and the long term, we mean 3 years or more. The board, we have an implementation board, or we planned to bring forward an implementation board, and that is going to be really key, because I think all of us can recognise that a strategy is only as good as implementation. Actually, writing the strategy can be the easy part often, but actually making sure that we have implementation of that strategy is going to be vital. So we have an implementation board that we will take forward. They will look at key milestones and measures of success. And we hope that the implementation board will meet before the end of this year, and their implementation plan will be finalised by spring 2022. Forgive the interjection. So hopefully that gives some reassurance to Ms Mackay, and if she needs more information, then of course I'm happy to provide it in writing.
It's lovely to hear that your daughter's cheering on the idea of a women's health plan. So, Gillian, did you have any follow-up
That's
questions
me.
There?
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm very interested in the idea of a focus on menopause health. Around menopause, and one of the recommendations in the Women's Health Plan is having specialist clinics for menopause. I'd like to ask for more detail on this. Obviously, the Women's Health Plan's only been out for a couple of weeks, but what provisions are proposed around having those specialist centres for women who have that more complex type of menopause? Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I recognise the role that you've played in relation to the Women's Health Plan and getting us to this point? I know you've often maybe felt like it's been a bit of a lone voice, because I know you've spoken about this for many, many years, but I'm really pleased that actually it has entered the mainstream consciousness, and that's why our Women's Health Plan is so important. So I think really critical to this will be the implementation of the strategy. So I've just mentioned in my answer to Ms Mackay, how the implementation board will ensure that key milestones and successes are made. What we're doing is already working at local health board level, because again, you can have a strategy at national level. If it's not there at local level, it's not going to be delivered. So I think really key to this will be the women's health champion. So as we've said, every single health board will have that women's health champion in place. They will drive forward that strategic change at a local level. They will promote that women's health plan where needed. They will support a network of local women's health experts and leaders as well. When it comes to a national women's health champion, we'll hopefully appoint somebody into that role next year. But what we'll also do at the moment is make sure we have those local structures in place, because what will work in one part of the country in terms of a specific menopause clinic may be different to what will work in an urban setting versus a rural setting, for example. So we want to leave this largely in terms of what a menopause clinic should look like to local health boards. But we're going to have somebody specified within a health board level to drive this change forward to make sure it's happening, as I say, at a local delivery level.
And is the idea to be, I guess, reaching out to I suppose, the wider public who've maybe, you know, been through a healthcare system with regards to menopause and feeding, getting public consultation and feeding back what that plan should look like?
Ideally, that would be the best absolutely way to do it. We know that, getting people with lived experience co-designing not just our policies, but our service are so important. And you know, excuse me, convener, from your own involvement, that the Women's Health Plan had co-design at its heart from women with lived experience, from a whole range of aspects, menopause, of course, periods, endometriosis, a number of other aspects of that Women's Health Plan were informed by women that had lived experience of those conditions. So for me, absolutely, that is the ultimately the best way to develop these clinics in terms of menopause specifically, by hearing from those women who suffer some of the more challenging effects of menopause to make sure the service is built around them. So there's no point building the service and the structure and then fitting people into it. You're much better to hear from the people, devise a system that is built around them.
Okay, thank you very much. We have more questions from Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener. I recently spoke in a debate about women's health, particularly my own journey with endometriosis. And it was wonderful to hear from so many women across Scotland that they welcome the government's plans for how we'll take this forward. But can the CAB Secretary give more detail about how we are going to reduce diagnosis times? Women are very, very interested in this. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I thank Ms Tweed for the fact that she has spoken again about her own experiences. I really do. I don't take it lightly when people share their own health experiences. I think that's a difficult thing to do, particularly standing in a parliamentary chamber. And doing so. So our Women's Health Plan goes into detail on how we'll do that. But what I would say to Ms Tweed is the best thing I can do is give her detail of what the Implementation Board will seek to do, because the implementation of these actions will be different in different local health board areas, because of course one size doesn't always fit all. So there's different pathways into referrals, but we know that the diagnostic side of endometriosis is something that we have to concentrate on. There will be funding available in relation to that, and investment accompanying the Women's Health Plan. But the Implementation Board will be absolutely vital to this. They will ultimately decide what is the best way to implement each of the actions. Some of them, I can promise you, some of them will be short-term actions, but equally some of them will be more medium to long-term actions as well. I can't wave a magic wand to help overnight, and I know that's not the expectation, but we'll take forward, particularly when it comes to endometriosis, some of those actions at speed, because we know just how much women suffer, but also how there's still challenges in around the diagnostics. So if it's okay, convener, I'm happy to write in more detail around the implementation of the Women's Health Plan to committee to give more detail to Ms Tweed, but particularly if I can do that in a time when we have a little bit more detail around the Implementation Board.
Thank you very much for that. And of course, we will be coming back to the Women's Health Plan in detail as well, but that would be very helpful. Evelyn, did you have any follow-up questions on that, or would you?
No, that's me. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I come to Emma Harper, who also has some questions around the plan?
Yep, thanks, Convener. Just a quick question, really, Cabinet Secretary, and it could be part of a further response to Evelyn Tweed's question as well. The cervical cancer self-screening research that's happening right now is really, really interesting. And I got involved because NHS Dumfries and Galloway were taking forward this self-sampling in order to capture the 6,000 women who had defaulted on their cervical smear test. So I'd be interested in an update about how the research is progressing, and are we likely to see a rollout of self-screening for cervical cancer, HPV particularly, is in Scotland. And so I would be interested in hearing an update.
Cabinet Secretary.
Forgive me, I don't have it to hand, but I'll get an update on that research and of course, write to committee. My concern in around cervical screening has been around some of the issues, obviously, that my colleague Marie Todd updated Parliament about the end of the last year, before summer recess. Of course, she's going to provide a further update shortly to Parliament too. And my concern is that we don't allow those issues, as absolutely unfortunate and regrettable as they are, not to take away from the importance of women coming forward for cervical screening. We know the effect, the positive impact that cervical screening programme has had on detecting cervical screening early, being able to treat it early and then having a more positive outcome. So I don't want those issues to detract away from the absolute positive benefits of that screening programme. So forgive me, Ms Harper, I don't have the most up-to-date analysis back from that research, which is still being undertaken. But when we have an update, I'm happy to write to committee, who will then, of course, feed that to committee members once we have that update.
Thank you very much. And a question from Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Kavina. Thanks. Just a brief question following Evelyn Tweed's around diagnosis and the amount of time for women to be diagnosed with endometriosis. Also, women speak to me about the fact that it's been a long journey for that, and then clinicians themselves acknowledge that they perhaps don't have the expertise. So just to put forward, and I'm sure it will be part of the plan, but it's very important that we do share expertise across the different clinicians, and where necessary training is available on these issues that's been raised by the women themselves.
Cabinet Secretary.
Agreed, and I should have said in my response to Ms Tweed's question that one of the actions within the plan is to commission endometriosis research, because Ms Mock is absolutely right. There are a number of people still, whether that's clinicians and indeed women themselves, who want to know more about this condition, understand that condition. So that research is there to develop better treatment and management, and hopefully a cure too. So we're commissioning that research, and that's one of the actions that's part of the Women's Health Plan, if that gives any comfort to Ms Mockin.
Thank you. That rounds off Women's Health Plan, but Annie Wells has got a final question for you, Cabinet Secretary, around health and wellbeing of staff. Annie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to ask this question. The Cabinet Secretary rightly started off the session by praising and thanking our frontline NHS and social care staff, which I think everyone across Scotland would agree with you. But he also mentioned the term that they were knackered. And I don't think that's just a physical health issue. I think that's also mental health and wellbeing. So I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary, what is already in place to support pandemic-related mental health and wellbeing issues for our NHS and social care staff? And will staff have protected time to use the wellbeing support that's available?
Cabinet Secretary.
I just want to thank Ms Wells for the question. She's right. It's not just about physical health. It's absolutely about mental health. I remember quite vividly a conversation with quite a senior nurse at a visit to a hospital, and she was in the high dependency unit, and somebody who is not a clinician, I had made the wrong assumption that somebody of her seniority, a nursing level, probably has seen, unfortunately, a number of people pass away, but actually she hadn't. But because that high dependency unit, of course, was overwhelmed at the beginning of the pandemic with so many people coming to it, the amount of death that she saw during the beginning of the pandemic was more than she'd seen in her entire career. And she said that had a huge mental health impact. And something just, maybe I'm stating the obvious, but it's just something that hadn't registered with me as a non-clinician. So huge mental health impacts. I agree entirely with Ms. Wells' assessment. So what are we doing about it? £8 million going into wellbeing. That is includes a range of initiatives. So we have the 24/7 National Wellbeing Helpline. We have the National Wellbeing Hub. We have the Coaching for Wellbeing. And we also have the Workforce Specialist Service. All of these resources are being used and used well. In fact, we know that the National Wellbeing Hub has been used over 115,000 times by health and care staff. And we know that the Workforce Specialist Service, again, the clue's in the name, of course, that specialist service being used as well. In terms of protected time, I'm absolutely open to that discussion. I'm more than happy to take that away with not just health boards, but also with our trade unions as well, and our staff side representatives. I'm certainly open-minded to it. It would come, obviously, with some challenges, given, of course, the current pressures that we have all spoken about on the health service. But it's absolutely key that if we want to recover our NHS, then staff wellbeing has to be at the heart of it. So I know the additional funding that we gave of £2 million that we're allocating to support primary care and social care workforce, that should help local teams to secure time for reflection and recovery to meet their identified needs. And this funding actually could also be used for locum cover and for backfilling costs as well. But in the broader issue of protected time for wellbeing, I'm more than happy to look at what more we can do in that regard.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We have come to the end of our questions, and I want to thank you for your time this morning, and also for Ms. Lamb and Professor Leach and Ms. Bell's time too. We will, of course, look forward to seeing you again for more updates on a lot of things that you have mentioned today. Before I let you go, is there anything else that you maybe want to say to the committee in terms of your priorities going forward?
No, thanks, Convener. I mean, there's a couple of issues, obviously, that we didn't touch upon, which you may be following up with other ministerial colleagues. But I would say, for example, when it comes to the national mission in terms of tackling drugs deaths, that's also a clear priority. For me, of course, Ms. Constance, my ministerial colleague, is taking forward that work. But just to give you committee an assurance, because I know how important it is to every member of the committee, that's an issue that she and I are working extremely, extremely closely on. And of course, if you want me to come back to committee, or indeed Ms. Constance, I'm sure she will come to committee to talk about that issue. But I just wanted to give you an assurance that from a Cabinet Secretary perspective, I'm working hard on that. I'm more than happy just to end to say, Convener, if you want me to come back to committee, even at particularly short notice, given, of course, the nature of the pandemic in which we're dealing with, and things can move extremely quickly, I will make myself available to committee whenever is suitable for you.
Well, thank you very much. And we have Ms. Constance coming in next week, so we'll look forward to asking her particular questions on that. Again, thank you for your time this morning, and we'll move on to our next item in the agenda. The third item in our agenda is consideration of subordinate legislation, and that's two negative instruments. The first instrument is the National Health Service Travelling Expenses and Remission of Charges Scotland, number 2 Amendment Regulations 21, and that is SSI 2021/241. This instrument amends the National Health Service Travelling Expenses and Remission of Charges Scotland number 2 Regulations of 2003. And that's SSI 2003/460, to make free dental care available to people aged between 18 and 25 years. And the second instrument is the Milk and Healthy Snacks Scheme, Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2021, and that's SSI 2021/274. This instrument amends the Milk and Healthy Snacks Scheme, Scotland Regulations 2021, that is SSI 2021/82. Its aim is to clarify and address technical issues to the operation of the Milk and Healthy Snack Scheme. Now, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has considered the two instruments, and both instruments were reported under reporting ground J, failure to comply with the 28-day laying period. But that is all that they have mentioned in relation to these negative instruments. And no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. So I would ask members if they have any comments to make on either of these instruments. Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. I just wanted to highlight or have a question, actually, as these breached because of COVID. Is that right? The laying of the instruments was it found to be a breach under Section 28, Number 2 of Interpretation and Legislative Reform. It's basically because of COVID that the breach was,
happened. That's correct. It was due to the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any other comments or questions? Okay, I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to these negative instruments. Does any member disagree with this? No, we've got full agreement. Right, at its our next meeting, on the 14th of September, the committee will hear from the Minister for Drugs Policy, Angela Constance, on her priorities for Session 6. But that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.